Howard, we all know, is immaculate. His wide knowledge has funneled in the right way, and we all are immensely gaining in that entire process. Today's session is quite helpful for the purposes of understanding the property law in respect of possessory, prescriptive, and proprietary laws. And therefore, we have written it as a masterclass on titles so that we can understand the subtle difference between all of them as to how, what is the interplay, as to whether there is an interplay of Demolition Act, Transfer of Property Act, Specific Relief Act. And I can see Mr. Prabhakar, meanwhile, while we are introducing him, he's just looking through the notes which he has shared with us. But I know that once he starts, they will be all flamboyant sixes like what Yuvraj had hit in England. So let's not take much time, and we'll ask Mr. Prabhakar to share his knowledge in his own style, the way we all enjoy. Over to you, Mr. Prabhakar.
Good evening, and thank you, Mr. Vikas. Happy Independence Day. The topic consists of three parts. One is possessory, prescriptive, and then proprietary. We can even say the order in which it has been coined, the topic, which is also relevant. Why I am saying this is this. The title which we talk about in courts consists of two parts. One is a possessory right and a proprietary right. But all cases of a title, whether it is prescriptive, proprietary, etc., it originally starts from possession. Whether it is in the Roman law or in the English jurisprudence or even the American jurisprudence, one can find that possession always plays a role in determining the title to the property. Why? The proprietary right can be traced to two or three centuries, whereas the possessory right, the tracing is time immemorial. The reasons are this. The registration of the properties started somewhere in the early part of the 19th century, somewhere in 1820 or 25. And therefore, any document which you can show your possession of the property can be only a subsequent to the early part of the 18th century and not beyond that. And therefore, the possessory right always plays a vital role in even in Indian jurisprudence. In fact, I would even go to say that possessory right, which we were calling it in the 19th centuries and 18th centuries as an occupancy right in respect of agricultural properties, is so invaluable that it was recognized not only under the property laws, but also in some of the ancillary laws like the grant made by the sovereign like a enum, where if a sovereign gives a right by way of a enum, the proprietary right in the soil or the occupancy right in the soil will always be protected. Therefore, one should bear in mind that possession is 9 points in law. What is 9 points in law? Somebody would say that it is 9 out of 10, except the proprietary right, namely the documentary evidence. Possession is everything. Even under Section 110 of the Evidence Act, possession is works forwards as well as backwards. Therefore, if you want to define a possessory right or a prescriptive right or even a proprietary right, the starting point is the possession or who is the first occupant of the property. Always in cases where there is a rival claimant, one claiming as a prescriptive right or another claiming a possessory right, then we can dwell upon the right in an order, namely proprietary right, then possessory right and prescriptive right. But a proprietary right, as I have said earlier, is goes beyond even the proprietary right which we talk about nowadays, namely the documentary evidence showing your title to the property. The occupancy right has got a great role to play and continues to do so, notwithstanding some hibernations during 2009 and 2010 when his lordship Dalveer Bhandari gave a shake to the entire possessory right concept by taking a cue from the European judgments that it is a violation of human rights. I'll come there when we go along. What is a prescriptive right? And how it is different from a possessory right or an adverse possession? A prescriptive right is based upon a fact of possession, which is judicially recognized by the courts for more than several centuries. But an adverse possession is based upon a statute under the English law or under the American jurisprudence as well. But in India, we always confuse this adverse possession with the right of prescription. Even though it overlaps to a certain extent, these two, under the European law, the American jurisprudence or the British common law principle, are two distinct concepts. Then what is a prescription and what is an adverse possession? Adverse possession, as you all know, commences in wrong and ends in right. If somebody is in possession of the property for a particular period of time, now the law says that it is 12 years. In case of a private individual and in case of a public, it is 30 years. Whereas in case of a prescriptive right, this is based upon a judicial decision. We will always be wondering whether the concept of adverse possession has been covered under any statute. It is not covered under any statute, but it is a common law principle, as it is the prescriptive right. But the difference is this: in case of an adverse possession, there is a statute, namely the law of limitation, which speaks about that. Namely, after a particular period of time, you will lose your right. But in case of a proprietary right, this is not a prescriptive right. This is not so. It's only a judicial decision and not depend upon the law of limitation. I can give you an example. If you have not prescribed title to the property by adverse possession, then can anybody prevent you from taking your property if somebody has trespassed into the property? Yes, there are principles, common law principles like latches, delay, and even estoppel. In case where you are the owner of a land, you are living in the neighborhood, somebody trespasses into the property and puts a construction, huge construction in the property. He thinks he is the owner of the property. You think that even though you have got a proprietary right, you are under the impression that somebody is constructing in his own property and keep quiet and actively encourages this man to put up construction. And if you encourage this man to put up construction, yes, you got a right to go ahead and put up construction. Then section 115 estoppel will come into play, a representation made and being acted upon by other party, you cannot go back. This is a right of under the estoppel, principle of estoppel, acquiescence and latches, notwithstanding the fact that 12 years period has not elapsed, notwithstanding the fact that somebody has prescribed title to the property, still you may lose and it can be arrested on a principle of estoppel or acquiescence, and even it can be called as a prescriptive right. Now, why this prescriptive right is so distinct from the adverse possession, I can very well cite some of the decision. One of the oldest of the judgment of the state of New York in Scallon versus Manhattan, where the lordship would swear that prescription is based purely upon possession, And whereas adverse possession is purely based upon limitation. The reason is this. Sometimes we can lose the property even if the other man has not prescribed title to the property. I'll come there in the later part of the discussion. And this principle has been touched upon by Her Lordship Indira Banerjee in a very recent case, but not making any distinction between adverse possession and prescriptive right. I'll come there. The second judgment of the American State New York High Court is Freedom versus Halfoster, 32 New York Journal 419, where also this principle has been reiterated. I can very well say that in one case by the Gujarat High Court, reported in AIR 1988, Gujarat page 31, in Vora Amini by Ibrahim versus Vora Tahir Ali Muhammad Ali, where the Lordship has took the view that you lose right to the property on the basis of prescription, not on the basis of limitation. I can also quote from my memory, there were two or three judgments on that aspect from the Madras High Court, which I have not cited in the note. One is AIR 1951 Madras, of His Lordship Govinda Menon in a division bench judgment, followed by AIR 1965 Madras, again a division bench. In both the cases, the court has held that even though the defendant has not prescribed title to the property, you will lose your right because of latches, acquiescence, and estoppel. In 65 Madras, the division bench went on further and said that you are not even entitled to compensation, as it is a natural corollary that once you lose your right to get back the property, as a natural corollary, you are not entitled to compensation also. Even though this principle has been unsettled by the subsequent decisions of the single judges of the High Court, wherein they have granted compensation. But the point at issue is, even if you have not, the other man has not prescribed title to the property, still the person who is the owner may lose his right. This is reiterated in AIR 1988, Gujarat, page 31. Now coming to the first aspect of the legal position, what is the possessory right? Whether it can give title to the property? What is all title is all about? We are not on a criminal law. Title, one should probabilize these in civil law jurisprudence. The probability is based with the court. If a title is under a scanner, it can be by two types. One is absolute title, and another is a comparative title. Or what we can say, the absolute title in cases where there are rival claimants claiming title to the property. I can give an example. Suppose the plaintiff comes forward with a case that he has got a right under a gift deed or a settlement deed or a testamentary disposition like a will. In all cases, if the plaintiff fails to prove the due execution, attestation, etc., as contemplated under law, either it is a gift deed or a will, then the other man, probably being a legal heir, may be entitled to the property. Therefore, in those cases, the title has to be proved absolutely, meaning that by if you pitch forward a case on the basis of a will or a settlement deed, the plaintiff must prove in accordance with the law, namely section 68, or in case of a will, section 63 of the Succession Act. If you fail to do that, then the defendant can also be a legal heir entitled to the property. The point at issue is, in such a case, the possession of the plaintiff may not be relevant because he derives a title from a document. And the either the vendor or the settlor or the testator might have been in possession of the property, and this possession may inure to all the legal heirs unless you are able to establish that the line of succession has been really broken by the executant. stating that there is a will or a settlement or a gift. In such a cases, the title has to be decided absolutely. Namely, you have to prove your absolute ownership over the property. But this absolute ownership is not applicable in cases where you are pitch forwarding a case of a right against a total stranger or a person who has no right over the property. Assuming for a moment you have got possession of the property for some time or quite a long time, and you have got some documents, but you are not able to prove your title to the property, but you are able to prove your possession for quite a long time, then this possession will be elevated to the status of a title insofar as the other man is concerned, who is a total stranger to the property and he has no right over the property. And if he, even in such cases, if the person who is in possession loses his possession, namely by way of a trespass before the filing of the sword, then he can also, on the basis of his previous possession, recover the property. Therefore, title is not absolute in all cases. There is no need for you to prove the title absolutely in all cases. It all depends upon the person against whom you want to pitch forward your title. If it is a total stranger, then there is no need for you to prove an absolute title. There are some cases where even the High Court, with the regret I would like to say, refuse to entertain the second principle, that even in case of a stranger, if you put forward a case of a title on the basis of the document that you are not able to prove your title, but you are able to prove your possession, still you will lose your right on the basis that the plaintiff has to prove his case and he cannot stand on the weakness of the defendant. Quite unfortunate in the sense, weakness of the defendant is different from proving your possessory right over the defendant or against the defendant. Weakness is something else, namely that absolutely you have no right over the property. You don't have any title. You don't have any possession. And then you want to point out, no, the defendant has no title at all. That may not be enough. But between title, possession, and lack of title and possession on the part of the other man, I am of the view that even if you don't have title to the property, the possession comes into play and you can take the property. Am I right on that principle? There is a judgment, AIR 1966 Supreme Court, namely, the decision, if I remember correctly, Saranga Deva Periya Madam versus Ramaswamy, reported in AIR 1966 Supreme Court, page 160. Saranga Deva Periya Madam versus Ramaswamy, AIR 1966 Supreme Court, page 160. Decision of three judges. A very interesting judgment. In a sense, a person was in long possession of the property. The property belonged to a mutt. He prescribed the title and he said that I have perfected my title to the property. Subsequently, the mutt took possession of the property. On the basis of this possession, mutt fought the case on the ground that they are the owners of the property. The person who has perfected his title to the property filed a suit for declaration and possession, stating that I have prescribed title to the property by adverse possession against the mutt, a religious institution. And once my right is perfected after a particular period of time, namely 12 years, then my title become absolute. And the fact that the mutt got the property again purely is a case of a trespass. I'm not sure whether any of the judges today will entertain this type of view. The Honorable Supreme Court took the view that once a person in possession of the property for a statutory period, and if he has perfected title to the property, his title becomes absolute. And if he is dispossessed by the very same man who is the absolute owner, still the absolute owner, having lost, having its rights having extinguished, must hand over the property to the person who is in possession. That's how the possession was safeguarded by the courts all these years. But the concept of possession, how the court has to entertain, we have been in a bad pace for the past 20 years before His Lordship Arun Mishra put a stamp on the such a thinking, namely to weed out adverse possession itself. But the long line of judgments should go to show that the possessory right as such was a right which can be pitched forward against anybody except the true owner. A person in possession even can ask for a declaration of his possessory right except against the true owner. Then who will be the true owner? It's not a weakness of the defendant. Suppose I say that I am in possession of the property for some time, and I establish that I am in possession, and then this possessory right can be used against everybody except the true owner. Then the person or the defendant who says that he is the true owner must establish that he is a true owner. Can we say that it is a weakness? I will not go into the such cases to say that it is for the plaintiff to prove. Not at all. But quite unfortunate, recently some of the judgments emanated from the Madras High Court as well as from the other High Court should say that the plaintiff has to prove his case, and one cannot take the weakness. Weakness is different, and the shifting of onus is different. In cases where a person is in possession, he is presumed to be the owner of the property, and the owner shifted to the other side to show that he has got a better title. The reason is that the question of better possession doesn't arise. The possession lies in the realm of the plaintiff to prove, and if he has proved such a possession, then the owner shifts. Reason is, possession is 9 points on law. It is a presumption of a prima facie title to the property. And if somebody else can come forward and say that I got a better title, the onus is upon that person to dislodge the case of the plaintiff. The court cannot shift his responsibility, saying that I don't want to see the case of the defendant because he is a defendant, you have to prove his case. In cases where a person comes to the court on the basis of title, what the court has to find is whether he has got title. Title may be a proprietary title, or even it may be a possessory title. A person who pitch forward a case of proprietary right may not be in a position to prove his proprietary right, but still he might have been in a position to prove his possessory right. In such cases, then possession comes into the fore, and the person who is in possession can very well maintain the suit even for a declaration of his possessory right, not question of injunction or a permanent injunction. It, even he can claim a right on title so long as the other man is not in a position to prove his better title. Always you will say in a suit for injunction, a person in possession is entitled to get an order of injunction against the whole world except the true owner. Why this concept was there is that a true owner cannot be injuncted from proceeding further. He is entitled to take the property back. In such cases, unless that possession ripens into that of a ownership, the question of preventing the other man from taking the property does not arise. Therefore, whether this possession ripens into that of a ownership is all depends upon two things. One is title, Secondly, the other man's lack of title. If the other man has no title at all, then the court has to see that and say that the defendant has no case and the plaintiff has no title. I want to dismiss the suit. What will happen to the property? Will it hang in the air? Therefore, in such cases, where a person is not in a position to prove his proprietary right, but has proved his possession, then unless and until the defendant comes forward and prove his case of title, the plaintiff is entitled to a degree on that score. It is not a question of weakness. Now coming to a property which cannot be normally possessed, a vacant site or a barren land. In all those cases, possession follows title. The person who is the owner, and if he is proves his proprietary right, then he is entitled to the property. Possession follows title. The discussion on that aspect can be seen in 2004-10 SEC, page 799. Karnataka Board of Waqf versus Government of India. A peculiar case where the Government of India took a case of an adverse possession and they got the stick from the Honorable Supreme Court. In that case, it was analyzed in detail that a person who is the owner of the property is presumed to be in possession. Non-user of the property won't affect. What is the non-user of the property? I can always even say, in case of a prescriptive right and a proprietary right, the distinction is this. Proprietary right is in respect of a possession of property. Prescriptive right is based upon user. What is the difference between user and possession? Possession is in respect of the property in exclusivity or in exclusion of others. But in case of a user, where a prescriptive right as a prescriptive easement under the Easement and License Act, etc., that right is a limited right. Namely, there will be the concept of a dominant owner and a servient heritage. And the person who is the owner of the property is entitled to the property subject to the right of easement or a prescriptive easement, whatever you call. But he'll still retain the ownership. But in case of a possessory right, once that possession ripens, the man who is the owner will lose his right over the property. Therefore, in case of a possessory right, it is the, in case of a proprietary right, it is the case of a possession of a particular property. In case of a prescriptive right, it is a mere user of a particular right. There is also a difference. User also depends upon the grant or how you use the property. Because it is different from an absolute possession. If you are an absolute owner of the property, what is the ownership? Ownership is to enjoy the property, to put up whatever you want in the property, to transfer that property. Three, you have got your right of destruction. These three things are vital in case of title. Namely, you should be in possession. You are entitled to use that property. You are entitled to transfer by such a usage. And three, you have got a right of destruction. Namely, if you have put up construction of the property, you need not seek anybody's permission to destroy that property and to build up something else. Therefore, these are the three things which is required in case of a title. And in case of prescriptive right, it is only a user. Suppose you are using a particular place for a particular purpose as a licensee, and then you don't have a right of exclusive possession because somebody else can also be using that. Then you don't have a right of destruction. You don't have a right of transfer unless the document suggests that you can write this easement. Easement goes with the land. Therefore, the limited right can be transferred, not the exclusive right of the proprietary right of the property. This distinction is always available. Then the next case is 2004 10 SEC, page 65. Amarendra Pratap Singh versus Tej Bahadur Prajapati. Amarendra Pratap Singh versus Tej Bahadur Prajapati. That was a case where the question of possession ripening into an adverse possession was considered. The Honorable Supreme Court has found that the adverse possession can also be by way of a default and neglect. Namely, nec me, nec ta, nec precario. These are the three things which is required. The possession should be open, adequate, and hostile to the true owner. Whether it is to be knowledge of the true owner, I am doubtful. There is no need for you to impart any knowledge to the true owner except in case of an ouster. Against many of the high courts for possession, namely uninterrupted, open, and hostile possession, should be brought to the knowledge of the true owner. Not at all. Not at all. Your possession should be open and the owner should be vigilant enough to find out that. In one case, if I remember, in 1921 Privy Council, when the concept of adverse possession was canvassed, the Honorable Privy Council jokingly has also said that in cases where a person is in possession of the property of another man, need not go to the top of the church and blow the trumpet to say that I am in possession of your property. That is not the job of the person who is in possession. What is required under law is you should be in possession continuously, uninterruptedly, openly, and hostile to that of the true owner. What is this hostility? Hostility is that if you acknowledge the right of the other man, then the question of adverse possession will never commence. Suppose you are in possession of the property in pursuance of a license, in pursuance of a lease, in pursuance of a usufructuary mortgage. In all those cases, your possession is referable to the other man's title. You acknowledge the title of the other man, and therefore you cannot make out a case of adverse possession unless where you disown the status of a licensing, you disown the status of a mortgagee, you disown the status of a lessee, and say that from this day, even though I was a licensee, I was a mortgagee in possession of the property at the earlier point of time, say from 1/1/1980, my possession has become adverse. It was brought to the knowledge of the other man also. Then in such cases, there should be a plea that you have to acknowledge the title at one point of time and then to disown the title or refute the title to make out a case of a possessory right. But the many courts have got themselves confused with regard to adverse possession and say that in all cases, you must acknowledge the title and you must take a plea of adverse possession. I don't think this is a right approach. In fact, if you go through the Ayodhya judgment, after a full reading of the judgment in two lines, the court has said that the Muslims did not take the plea of adverse possession seriously, thinking that they have to acknowledge the title of the temple. But no law has been laid on that aspect. But my view is different, because if you want to acknowledge the title in all cases, your right will be doomed. You can't prescribe title by adverse possession. In all cases, you can't expect the defendant to come forward only with a plea of adverse possession or a possessory right against the true owner. In many cases, which practically we find that the defendant will trace his own right to the property. He will trace his right to the property, namely a sale deed or any document. And at the same time, you will also say that my possession against the plaintiff is adverse for some reasons. I can give you example also. Suppose a person has traced his title to 100 years, namely 2 or 3 sale deeds. Whereas the plaintiff would come forward and say that on the basis of some documents, I am the absolute owner, my predecessor has got title, therefore I am entitled to the property. The defendant, in such a case, he has got some documents for 100 years. Can you expect him to disown all the documents and then to pitch the case of adverse possession alone, admitting the title of the plaintiff? It is a sheer stupidity. No lawyer will take such a plea. If no lawyer can take such a plea, how the concept of adverse possession can survive? Is it so limited in cases where the defendant knew full well that the plaintiff is the absolute owner and then I have prescribed title to the property? I don't think so. The reason is this. There is always a right for the defendant to take an alternative plea. If he make a plea on title, proprietary title, or even a possessory right, if he traces title to the property on the basis of some documents which is not referable to the plaintiff, plaintiff traces his title to 1A, defendant traces his title to B, and at the same time the defendant wants to say that I am the owner of the property, I have purchased the property from the predecessor of so and so under a sunset document, namely B. And he can also say, notwithstanding my purchase, I have been in possession of the property for a pretty long time. I have prescribed a title against the defendant, against the plaintiff. This is not destructive. This is not the question of acknowledging the title of the plaintiff. It is not mandatory for any person to acknowledge the title of the plaintiff in such cases to make out a case of adverse possession. This concept of a person in possession assumed to be the owner can be referred to an interesting judgment of the English court in Perry versus Clissold. Perry versus Clissold. In that case, reported in 1907 AC, page 73, it was held that a person in possession assumes the character of the owner. This judgment was subsequently, if I remember correctly, in 1951 Supreme Court, it has been approved by this Honorable Supreme Court that the view of the Privy Council in the English judgment in 1907 AC, page 73, is good even in India. The next judgment which I like to talk about is the extinction and Article 64 and 65. How the possessory right will ripen, how it will extinguish. One can say that all possessory right is traced to Limitation Act. The Limitation Act before 1908, if I remember 1873 or 73, was the old act. In that old act, a person in possession of the property for mere 6 years, I tell you mere 6 years, his possession will ripen into that of a title. And then people thought that this 6 year period is too small a period to perfect title, and therefore it has to be enlarged. It was enlarged to 12 years in 1908 Limitation Act under Article 132 and 134. And in respect of public property, it was raised to 30 years. But the fact of the matter is, that this 1908 Act speaks about two things. that a person who has got title to the property must also establish that he was in possession of the property within a period of 12 years at the time of filing the suit. It is two-pronged. Namely, he must prove title. Title is not enough. He must prove possession, that he was in possession of the property within a period of 12 years before the filing of this suit. But the law was changed in 1963. When the new act came, Article 64 and 65 came into being, and in case of a suit on possession, the person has to prove that he was in possession within a period of 12 years before the filing of the suit, Article 64. Article 65 would say that if a suit is based on title, then once he proves title, it is enough. The adverse possession will start from the day the defendant start enjoying the property adversely and it has reached 12 years. This was the distinction. What was the distinction in originally? The person has to prove title and possession. That is, he was in possession of the property prior, 12 years prior to the filing of the suit. The burden is wholly upon him. But when Article 64 and 65 was enacted, 64, if it is based upon possession and dispossession, Article 64 will apply, and then the person has to show that he was in possession of the property for 12 years. If it is purely on the basis of title and not on the basis of previous possession, then 12 years from the day when the possession of the defendant becomes adverse under Article 65. This was lucidly discussed by His Lordship in a judgment in, reported in AIR 2004 Supreme Court. I have not cited the judgment. His Lordship Kapadia went on to say that which one of the article will apply, in whether it is Article 64 or 65. He said in all cases where the plaintiff makes a plea of possession and dispossession at a particular point of time, then the cases will be covered only under Article 64. The party must prove that he was in possession of the property for within 12 years before the filing of this suit. Article 65 is an exception and it will not be applied in all cases. And His Lordship, if I remember, used the word, however camouflaged you have drafted the plaint. The real intention of the party is from the pleading that there was a case, it was a case of possession, dispossession, and then coming to the court. Article 64 applies, then he has to prove his dispossession within 12 years. If you want to apply Article 65, then please do remember that if you make a plea of trespass at a particular point of time, you must establish that. You cannot then bank upon the title and Article 65 can be invoked. In many cases, I have come across many of the high courts have done that mistake repeatedly, that they will take into the case in all cases where a person has filed a suit for declaration and possession, 65 will apply. If you file a suit only for possession, 64 apply. Astonishingly, neither Article 64 nor Article 65 speaks about a declaration. Declaration comes under Section Article 58 and 59. Which is a period of 3 years is given. Therefore, if a declaratory right is accompanied by possessory right or some other right injunction, then this Article 64 or 65 has to be 15 and not 58. That is the settled position. But the point at issue is, once an allegation is made in the plaint that there was a case of a trespass, then it is all doomed. You have to invoke only Article 64 and you must prove your possession. And the next decision, AIR 1981 Supreme Court 1165, Kishit Chandra Bose versus Commissioner of Ranchi. This is a case where the possessory right and what is the nature of possessory right and what has to be pleaded by the parties. The court said that A person in possession of the property, if it is open and hostile, it is enough. There is no need for you to bring the your possession to the knowledge of the true owner, except in cases of ouster. Where the ouster will come, in case of a co-sharers or joint owners, then possession by one person is possession in respect of all. Therefore, in such a cases, you must make a plea not of mere adverse possession, but the ouster. In such a cases alone, your possession or an hostile title must be brought to the knowledge of the co-sharer or a co-owner of the property. I remember there is a judgment in AIR 1967, Punjab and Haryana, speaking about this possessory right, namely ouster. They'll give 10 points how it has to be approached. The point is, therefore, knowledge is not necessary in case of a stranger. It is only in case of a co-owner or a co-sharer that has to come into play. Then, the next decision is 2006-7 SEC, page 570. Anjanappar vs. Somalingappa. Anjanappar vs. Somalinganappa. That was a case where the true owner of the property came out with the case that I was not aware. I was ignorant of my property itself. I was not even aware that this property belongs to my family. And he comes forward with a suit. The court said that the ignorance of the other man's possessory right by the owner is immaterial. It will not prevent the running of time against you. The reason is this: you should be vigilant. You cannot say that I was keeping quiet, I was not aware, etc. Then the time will run out. Right will ripen into that of an absolute possessory right. What the Lordship would say, capable of being known is enough. That was the language used. If somebody takes some adequate precaution, and it is enough if he is able to find out, he can find out that capability to know is enough, and he need not know it at all. Therefore, again, the knowledge is immaterial. What is material is this person, if he is prudent man, an ordinary reasonable man, he could have find that out. That is enough for prescribing the right. Now coming to two decisions which I have set the clock back due to some interpretation which I think is not right. AIR 2009 Supreme Court page 103. AIR 2009 Supreme Court page 103. Hemaji Vaghaji versus Bikabai Gangarbai. Hemaji Vaghaji versus Bikabai Gangarbai. AIR 2009 Supreme Court page 103. And the second judgment, State of Haryana versus Mukesh Kumar, 2011-10 SEC page 404. Both the judgments are by His Lordship Dalivir Bhandari. For the first time, His Lordship Dalivir Bhandari of the Honorable Supreme Court referred to some English judgments and said that, in fact, he has extensively quoted judgments in J.A. Pai versus UK of His Lordship Justice Neuberger. And Pai versus Grahams, that was reported in 2003 WLR 242. What happened was this. Justice Neuberger was forced to go into the question of the right of possession as opposed to the human rights, because UK was part of a European Union. And then he was of the view that the right to possession of an immovable property, losing it by adverse possession, is violative of one Article 1 of the human rights, because the right to property is also a human right. Extensively, this judgment was quoted by His Lordship Dalivir Bhandari, stating that the law has changed, there is a new thinking, etc. Quite unfortunate, because for 10 years the clock has been set back for no fault of anybody in India. I'll tell you why the reason is. The entire fulcrum of the decision of His Lordship Dalivir Bhandari was based upon the decision of His Lordship Justice Neuberger in Pai versus UK and Pai versus Grahams. In both the cases, what happened was, the Justice Neuberger was forced to take into account the right to an immovable property juxtaposed to that of a human rights violation under Article 1 of the European Union. He was of the view that the losing a right to a thief or a person who is a rank encroacher or a trespasser is a violation of a human right as contemplated Article 1. These two judgments of His Lordship Bhandari emanated from this principle of the English law. But quite unfortunately, this decision, namely Pai versus UK of His Lordship Justice Neuberger, was reversed by the Grand Chamber of the European Human Rights. In fact, in 2005 itself, stating that the possessory right or an adverse possession is not violative of the Human Rights Charter of European Union. The entire foundation on which the edifice of His Lordship Dalivir Bhandari was built, namely that of Pai versus UK and Pai versus Grahams, these two judgments of His Lordship Justice Neuberger stating that there is a violation of the human rights. He wants to stretch that principle, brought it to India, and then suddenly, all the high courts started thinking that this right by adverse possession is not good. You are protecting a thief. You are protecting an encroacher. You are protecting a trespasser. Forgetting for a moment, any right to property starts with the possession by one person. Whether it is a Roman law or an English law, or even the American jurisprudence, it all speaks about the fact that any right to property starts with the first occupant. Therefore, can we call him as a thief? Can we call him as an encroacher? Second, the law wants to have some time limit so that the society can move on further. If this type of judgments comes, that the possessory right has to be negative, then it will open the Pandora's box. There won't be any end to it. Hundreds of years, there will be litigation. At one side, we want to say that we have to reduce the litigation, use technology, etc. And at the same time, you want to say that you can't put the limitation. Let them come. We will teach a lesson. That's not the idea of law. The point is, therefore, when the decision of His Lordship Dalivir Bhandari is based upon a decision which has been subsequently reversed, no court in India has taken note of this fact. Till today has not taken note of this fact. But quite unfortunately, in 2014, His Lordship Sikri came out with another googly, where His Lordship A.K. Sikri, with due respect to him, he took a stand that the plea of possessory right cannot be won as a plaintiff, but you can only defend that right because it is only a shield and not a sword. Quite unfortunate that he referred to some 74 or 75, if I remember correctly, a judgment of the Punjab and Haryana High Court, in which it has been stated that because Article 65 says that 12 years period of the defendant. The word defendant is used in the Limitation Act. The statute of limitation is for preventing a man to come to the court. But the remedy of adverse possession and the prescriptive right are the common law remedy. But before this Slanship Sikri's judgment, there were a lot of judgments of this Honorable Supreme Court which says that the possessory right can be declared for a person who comes to the court as a plaintiff. But this went on for some more time. Unfortunately, it came before the bench of His Lordship Arun Mishra. Where is Lordship? In Ravindra Kaur Grewal versus Manjit Kaur. Ravindra Kaur Grewal versus Manjit Kaur. Reported in AIR 2019, Supreme Court 3827. AIR 2019, Supreme Court, page 3827. As Lordship analyzed all the judgments on that aspect about the adverse possession. In fact, it went into the another aspect also. Namely, even in case of a religious institution, possession can be prescribed. That was a old law reported in the 1966 Supreme Court Sarangadeva Periyamadam's case. Therefore, the law has been restored to its due position by His Lordship Arun Mishra in Ravindra Kaur's case. Suddenly, we find that in a period of 2 years, many courts before the trial court, as well as they started entertaining the plea of adverse possession, which they don't want to go because of the judgment of His Lordship Dalivir Bhandari, reported in 2009 and 2010. Ultimately, the final nail in the coffin is that of the Ayodhya case, where the Lordship said that the possessory right is an invaluable right. If you went through the entire 1,045 pages of the Supreme Court, it would say that there are issues which have been raised on either side, but there is no proprietary title to the property in favor of the temple or claimant of the temple, nor in respect of the claimant of the mosque. The court ultimately went into the question of possession and upheld the right of possession, namely the temple was in existence much prior to the mosque. A judgment which says that an idol is not a minor. A judgment which says that the lost grant is a principle which cannot be extended to the right of the people who claim it is a mosque. The reason was this. The lost grant principle can be applied only in cases where nobody has got title to the property and somebody has got a right of possession. Remember, this is a case of an absolute necessity of upholding the right of possession. If there is no valid grant in favor of anybody for that matter, suppose two parties fight, and both of them doesn't have title, but some third party has no title, then the question of last grant doesn't arise at all. The last grant principle, which the people who supported the mosque raised that issue before the Honorable Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court rejected that idea on the ground that it is not a case of anybody else, nobody else has got any right. The right of possession, which predates 3 or 4 centuries or 5 centuries back, by itself will ripen into title. That's what the Honorable Supreme Court has said. That is Siddiq versus Mahant Suresh Das. I think a portion of the judgment has been reported. If you want to read and to be thorough on the possessory right, go and read the judgment of Ayodhya. Not only of Slashep, the Supreme Court, but also 3 volumes of the Allahabad High Court Lucknow bench. But 3 judges took a view about this possessory right in 3 different ways. One of them is Lordship Vinod Sharma came to the conclusion that Supreme Court has said that the entire property goes to the temple on possessory right. Whereas Sudhir Agarwal came to a conclusion that they got only 1/3 right each on the basis that both of them has got some possession. This was also accepted by his lordship Ayub Khan when he said that all the three have got some right. Ultimately, the Honorable Supreme Court said that nobody has pleaded the case of partition, which I find that may not be correct. If a person comes to the court for a declaration and possession or injunction, and court find that the plaintiff is not entitled to the entire property but only a portion of the property, and if all other sharers are available, the court can very well grant a relief of partition, because the relief of partition is a lesser relief than that of on title. That was the principle under which his lordship Sudhir Agarwal and Ayub Khan took the view that is 1/3 can be allotted to each. But on principle, the Supreme Court considered that there was no plea and therefore we can't entertain that plea. What has been said by his lordship Sudhir Agarwal and Ayub Khan is that to put an end to all the problems, he said that let them take each 1/3. On appreciation of evidence, they may be wrong. But on a legal plane, I was of the view, and even now I am of the view, that the High Court was right in coming to a conclusion that in a suit for declaration and injunction, the court can grant a degree for partition. And now, the possessory right as an alternative relief. How it can be claimed? I was touching upon that subject. Straight away, I will take the decision. In 2009, 13 SEC, page 229, Aswatthama versus Prakash. 2009, 13 SEC, page 229, Aswatthama versus Prakash. There is a very interesting judgment of his lordship Ravindran, known for his knowledge on the civil law, where his lordship would say that it is not as though a person cannot take the inconsistent plea of title and adverse possession simultaneously. He can take. But there are cases where you can take and there are cases where you cannot take. His lordship would say that a person cannot take the plea of title and adverse possession, plea of title and adverse possession in cases where a person, if he traces title and possession to the very same person to the very same point of time, namely the plaintiff, then he cannot take such a plea. Suppose the plaintiff comes forward and says that I am the absolute owner of the property. The defendant traces title to the plaintiff and traces title of adverse possession to the plaintiff himself. Namely, in cases of a mortgage or a lessee to the plaintiff, you say that I am the owner. I am also in adverse possession against the plaintiff because of this lease, deed or mortgage. That is not possible. His lordship was very clear that only in such cases where the defendant traces his title to the defendant, he cannot take the plea of adverse possession as well. But in cases where a person traces his title to some third party, for three generations, I am in possession of the property. My great-grandfather purchased the property from X, and X purchased the property from Y to Z. And he traces title, I am the owner of the property. And at the same time, notwithstanding my all these title, my possession against the defendant is adverse. Why not? Why you should not take such a plea? In all cases where you want to bring forth a case of possessory right, you have to trace your title. That is a practical difficulty. Then you also say that my possession against this man is adverse. The reason is this, very simple. Possession, adverse possession or a possessory right is talked about only as against the plaintiff who has come forward with the suit. Whereas my title is referable to a third party. These two are not inconsistent. This is an alternative plea. His lordship Ravindran succinctly came out with the decision, but what he would say on facts, he said that in such cases, In that case, he has not prescribed title to adverse possession. I go by the title. That is a different issue. The second judgment on that aspect is Rame Gowda versus Varadappa Naidu, 2004, 1 SEC, page 769. Where the question of alternative plea was considered, the court said that the title and alternative plea can be taken. Once you have to see the pleading and see whether the title and the adverse possession are traced to the very same person, namely the plaintiff or plaintiff's predecessor in title. If it is not, he is entitled to take such a plea. If it is so, then he is barred. The next aspect on that question of a presumptive right. A person in possession is presumed to be the owner. Very interestingly, one case came from the Supreme Court in 2020 Supreme Court, page 3688. AIR 2020 Supreme Court, page 3688. Edelweiss Asset Management versus Perumal Swami. Edelweiss Asset Management versus Perumal Swami. AIR 2020 Supreme Court, page 3688. An interesting case. A person is in possession of the property. He had obtained a patta, what you call in the North India as a katta or something like that. The revenue record stood in the name of the person who is in possession. Normally, we think that patta is not a document of title, maybe a document of possession. A document showing possession. The court went on to say in that judgment that patta shows possession. Possession shows that you are the owner. In case where the defendant has no right at all to a property and a person produces a patta and says that he is in possession and he establishes his possession, what the Honorable Supreme Court say in such a cases, no doubt patta is not a document of title, but patta can be taken for proof of possession. And if a person proves his possession, possession emanates from title to the property. Therefore, you can't brush aside the right of possession saying that it is I won't see the case of the defendant at all. Because the court is precluded from seeking the weakness. It is not a weakness, shifting the onus. Now, coming to the two latest judgments, very interesting. One is AIR 2020 Supreme Court, page 4321. AIR 2020 Supreme Court, page 4321. Nazir Mohammed versus Kamala. Nazir Mohammed versus Kamala is Lordship Indira Banerjee. This is a case where the Honorable Supreme Court came to a conclusion that a person has to prove title and possession within the period of limitation. As I have said, that Article 64 may apply in such a cases because you say, if a person, I am in possession, I have been dispossessed, the defendant has trespassed at a particular point of time, I am coming to the court. Then the case has to be fitting under Article 64. Under Article 64, the party has to prove his title and his possession within 12 years. The Lordship would say, in such a case, that was a very interesting case in the sense, the defendant did not take a proper plea of adverse possession. That is a stray sentence in the written statement. What the Lordship would say, there is no need for us to go into the question of adverse possession at all. The plaintiff has come to the court. The plaintiff must prove his title and he is in possession of the property within a period of 12 years. If it is not so, there is no need for us to go into the question of adverse possession. It has even structured the principle further. Adverse possession need not be pleaded at all. Exact words need not be pleaded. What a Lordship could say, adverse possession is an inference from the facts. If I am able to establish by way of some documentary evidence or oral evidence, etc., that my position is after all adverse, there is no need for me to plead exactly, I have perfected my title by adverse possession and prescription, etc. That's what the Lordship would say. The very interesting judgment in the sense that in all cases where the high courts, district courts and the trial courts, if there is no proper plea, what is a proper plea according to the lower courts, you know, you must plead from date. The exact date must be given. These are all not necessary in all cases. The exact date, year, month of your possession commencing as adverse will arise only in cases where the defendant says that I am in possession of the property as a lessee of the plaintiff. I am in possession of the property as a mortgagee under the plaintiff. I am in possession of the permissive occupier under the plaintiff. In all these cases, the party must disown his status as a lessee or a mortgagee or a licensee and then should start enjoying the property adversely. In such cases alone, the exact date and year are necessary. In cases where you trace your title to somebody else, and try to pitch a case of a possessory right against the plaintiff, you have to prove the documents. There is no need for a specific plea. Why? I tell you why. In the first set of cases, your possession is referable to the plaintiff. You have been in possession under the plaintiff on some color, namely mortgage or lessee. The plaintiff will be thinking that your possession is only that of a mortgagee or a lessee or a permissive occupier. In such cases, you must plead when you have disowned such a right and then started enjoying the property adversely. In such cases alone, you have to stick to one, kick the other. Stick to one, kick the other. But not in all cases. But if you take a plea of independently, if you plead, make a plea of adverse possession against the plaintiff, but title against the third man, then there is no need. What is required is you can defeat the right of the plaintiff by showing your possession beyond the period of 12 years. The exact date is, in such cases, is not necessary. Though the courts have confused themselves, these two concepts, please keep in mind that a right by adverse possession is not a shame. Just imagine, before 1908, a person in possession of a property for 6 years is entitled to the property. Those were the days we don't have any exposure to technology. We can't go and verify the property. The period is so small. Now, it is 12 years. The technology is there. Nobody will allow somebody to enjoy the property adversely for 12 years and keep quiet. Instead of reducing the period, in 63, it's all right, we have increased the period to 12 years. Now, if you see his Lordship Dalit Bhandari judgment, there was a clarion call to the parliamentarian that this 12-year period must be increased at least. That was the second judgment when he thought that the first judgment did not get the resonance in 2009, namely Yamaji's case. In the next Mukesh Kumar, State of Haryana versus Mukesh Kumar, he pitched a case of at least increase the period. There's no need at all. There's no need at all. Now coming to the last of the aspect, vesting. One of the interesting judgment of his Lordship Tarun Chatterjee, reported in AIR 2009, Supreme Court. Kaliyamurthy and another, Kaliyamurthy and another versus Pai Gori Thaikal, Kaliyamurthy and another versus Pai Gori Thaikal, Waqf and others. Yeah, 2009 Supreme Court, page 840. That was a case where two of the limitation acts were considered, namely that of the 1908, 1963, and how the possession will ripen. What happened was in the Waqf Act, one Section 107 was amended, stating that in case of a suit for possession, the Limitation Act will not apply. Then this was taken into account to show that as there is no limitation, Buck can file the suit at any point of time. The difference taken was that the right to the Buck has all been extinguished even under the 1908 Act. Before the 1963 Act came into force. Why this was taken? As I have said earlier, that under the 1908 Limitation Act, you must prove title as well as your possession within 12 years. If you are not in possession for a period of 12 years before the 1963 Act came into force, then that right will ripen into ownership. Then you can't recover the property. Subsequently, the 63 Act came. 63 Act, there is a marked difference with regard to suit on title, where the possession of the defendant should be 12 years. But this Act went further, this came, where it was 107 of the Wack Act has been taken into account, where is the Limitation Act was taken out of the contest. It was argued before the court that the Limitation Act is not there, therefore they are entitled to properties. Lord Chief Tarun Chatterjee went into the entire gamut of issues and came to the conclusion. The right of the Waqf have all been extinguished under the old Act of 1908, before the advent of 1963 Act. The 1963 Act, even though there was a new Article 65, a right by extinguishment, a right based on somebody else, that somebody else is entitled to the property, and a right already vested on somebody by way of a possessory right, it cannot be taken away by the Limitation Act 1963, leave alone Section 107 of the Buck Act. The Lordship went on to say, once there is a vested right, once your right is extinguished, there was Article 28, new article under 1908, extinguishment is under Article 28. In 1963 Act, it is Article 27. Both of them speaks about extinguishment. Now, taking this Lordship Tarun Chatterjee's judgment forward, and read with the hardship Arun Mishra's judgment as well as that of Indira Banerjee's judgment, I am of the view that we have come a full circle. The possessory right has been restored. That in cases where a person is in possession of the property for a period as contemplated in the 1908 Act and has perfected his title, extinguished somebody's right even before the Limitation Act 1963 came into force, then his right cannot be taken away. The Lordship would say that vesting cannot be taken away by a new act. In the it is also considered Section 31 of the Limitation Act, where the lower courts have failed to do it. Section 31 of the Limitation Act speaks about the right which has already settled in somebody under the old law cannot be right. Therefore, any extinguishment made under the original 1908 Act cannot be revived by the amendment or the change in the clause of the Article 65 of the Limitation Act. The last of the point, which I'll stop again, time is over. With regard to the last grant, which I have said, yeah, 1948 Privy Council, page 25, Sangar Narayanan Pillaiyan versus Board of Commissioners for the Hindu Religious Endowment. In fact, in one of the cases, recent cases which from the Supreme Court, if I remember correctly, is of His Lordship Nageswar Rao, in respect of one hill at Madurai, where both courts, the trial court as well as the High Court, has held that the entire hill belonged to the temple by way of a lost grant, refused to accept the theory even in case of a religious institution. And the court said that the theory of lost grant cannot be applied indiscriminately. Lost grant means that in cases where evidence is lacking in respect of title on everybody, then we can use this. Somebody is in possession of the property, mere possession by itself, if shown to be for a particular period of time, then on the basis of the last grant, he can claim title to the property. But if the property, if the property has got title deeds, or somebody has got title deed in respect of some property, then the question of applying the grant does not arise. What is the difference between lost grant and adverse possession? Adverse possession can be used against a particular individual. Lost grant can be used against anybody. Namely, as I have said, in case of adverse possession, it is under a statute. Namely, the Limitation Act speaks about 12 years, now 30 years in case of a public property. But in case of a prescriptive right, that is, that embargo is not there. Even in case of a lost grant, I need not prove my possession that it is adverse to somebody else. Because unless you know the owner, where is the question of prescribing title against that owner? In such cases where a person in possession of the property for 5 years or 7 years will be protected if there is no evidence in respect of title on anybody. I leave the podium to Mr. Vikas. Everybody may not have the patience after 1.5 hours.
The question is, how do you remember everything? And to speak that extempore. That's the key. This is only one question has come. Can original vendor take the plea of adverse possession contending that the purchaser had never taken the possession of property while executing registered sale deed? And it is with the vendors for more than 12 years.
So that's the chat.
There's only one question.
One, can original not take a plea of adverse possession contending that never taken possession of the property? Yes, it can be done. I can remember there was one judgment of His Lordship S.S. Subramani of the Madras High Court reported in 1992 that there was a case of a sale deed of the year 1956, but the vendor continued to be in possession of the property after selling the property. The court has held that the person who has purchased, assumed to have purchased the property, lost his right. Therefore, he can maintain the suit.
This is by Ganpati. When the claim is based on title, where will the rise animus intention to possess as against the true owner, and how can the alternate plea of title and adverse possession be taken together?
Yeah. Again, in all cases, what is the animus? We have to address the issue of animus. The intention is not to enjoy the property adversely. Please note that the intention is to enjoy the property as my property. In cases where I am tracing title to my own vendor, simultaneously I can trace the right of adverse possession to the person who comes to the court, a stranger. The reason is this. The animus is to enjoy the property adversely against the owner or the person, a plaintiff, and as a title holder against my vendor. If my vendor comes to the court, the story is different. Therefore, the animus is not an absolute principle. Animus is only an intention to enjoy the property. And once it is on the basis of some registered documents, the possession is adverse from the date of the registered document. Kindly see AIR 2000 Supreme Court as well as AIR 1970 Supreme Court. Possession becomes adverse automatically from the date of a void document. Assuming for a moment the plaintiff is the owner, I have purchased the property from third party and continue to be in possession for 12 years and more, still I can take the plea of adverse possession. Animus is not an absolute animus that I should enjoy the property adversely through the, again, the whole world. Animus is to enjoy the property adversely again the person who claims by coming to the court.
In animus also, because they are young students also. Redmi has got himself unmuted. Yeah. Meanwhile, what is lost grant?
No questions.
What is lost? What is lost grant? I tell you, the lost grant is a principle in which the even in the Ayodhi cases it has been discussed. What has been pleaded by the parties who claim right by way of a mask in this premises is this: neither the Hindu people, assuming for a moment, nor the Muslims have got a proprietary right of ownership over the property. Then it was argued by Dr. Rajiv Dhawan that this was a case of a lost grant. The court refused to entertain the plea on the ground that in case of no evidence alone, the case of lost grant can be taken into account. Why this was taken by the Muslim people is this: in that case, rightly or wrongly, there was a mosque constructed somewhere in 1500 AD, continued to be there in the place. There was no evidence of anybody claiming possession according to them. There is no other evidence of anybody else could have got some right. Then it was pointed out that in the case on hand, there are enough evidence to show that beneath the mosque, there was a Hindu structure. Archaeological survey says that there is a structure, Hindu structure. We believe that. Therefore, it is not a case of no evidence. Therefore, we cannot apply the principle of lost grant. Again, the same principle is applied in Madurai's case, Kalladagar's case, where the Lordship Nageswara would say that it cannot be applied because there are evidence to show the other man has got some right. Therefore, we are not going into the question of lost grant. And somebody has asked me a question: walk for a temple property adverse possession can be taken after how many years? Till today, I am of the view that there is no distinction between a waqf, temple, or an individual. The law makes a distinction between a private owner and the government property or a public property. In case of a public property, it is 30 years. In case of a private individual, it is a 12 years period. Even in case of a waqf and a temple property, it is only 12 years. But there are some state laws, as Kaliyamurthy's case, where His Lordship Tarun Chatterjee took the view that is a case of a waqf act where the limitation act has been deleted, non-applicable in case of a suit for possession. Therefore, it is only 12 years in case of a waqf for a temple property. And somebody has asked me one question: principle of possession is 9 points in law. Don't think that it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 9. 9 points, namely constructive possession, absolute possession, exclusive possession, adverse possession, permissive occupier, lessee, mortgage. This is not what is contemplated on possession in 9 points in law. This possession in 9 points law is 9 out of 10. Namely, it means that if a person is in possession, he is entitled to protect his possession because possessory right is an invaluable right. That's what it means.
Yeah, you can ask your question. You have been unmuted. Yeah. You want to ask a question? No, it's fine. Yeah. So thank you, Mr. Prabhakar. for sharing your knowledge. As usual, you have taken us to the entire spectrum of knowledge of law, and the chat itself reflects that how much people have enjoyed. That Murku Swami says, lost grant is no evidence of title. What is it? What would it mean?
I'll take that question. The lost grant is no evidence of title. Absolutely. It can be applied only in, there is no evidence of title on any party. Then only it can be applied. In today's world, it is very, very difficult to apply this theory in respect of properties.
So, happy Independence Day once again, and keep on enjoying freedom of thought and freedom of expression, coupled with the knowledge. They say knowledge is power, and off late they are saying learning is more important power. And once we have speakers like Mr. Prabhakar to share his learnings and knowledge, I'm quite sure that people will get more empowered. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe, stay blessed. Thank you, Mr. Prabhakar. We will connect back. Jai Hind.